Decided, hey boo, hey Dejanay, we decided to just be unscripted, just be candid. Oftentimes you all, you see me and you alone, and Pastor Brennan, my wife, normally she's, I would say camera shy, should I say, but she
this
said,
this won't be long, y'all. We got 20 minutes, but I got a word, I got a word. Call a neighbor, call a friend. It's about to go down, y'all. I'm just playing.
It's about to go down. What you got to say, baby?
I'm just talking with you.
No, you're not with me. Talk to the people. Come on, let's talk to the people. What you got to say?
What y'all want to talk about?
I don't know. You talk to them. Hey, Kyle, I need to see you Sunday, man. What you got to say? You want...
I really don't have anything to say. Hey, Crystal.
You don't have nothing to say?
No, I'm just...
What advice would you give to those that are, for the women that are waiting on God, and it seems as if that they're in a place called frustration? Mm-hmm. What would you say to them? What would you minister? Give them words of wisdom. I want to hear what you would say to a woman that is waiting on God, and it seems as if God is just not doing what we expect him to do. Talk to the people.
Hey, y'all. Okay, so what I would say is to be not weary in your well-doing, because in due season you shall reap. Mm-hmm. And when you know your worth, then that makes it even a more reason why you want to hold on to your goods. Mm-hmm. So you have to value yourself, and then others will value you. Mm-hmm. So don't, you know, I like to tell the ladies that will listen, mm-hmm. you know, you're top shelf. Mm-hmm. So when you know that you're top shelf, that means you have to reach up to get you, right?
Mm, that's good.
So it's just like, let's not be too deep. When we're in the world, the top shelf looker is up high. Mm-hmm. And it also has a big price tag.
Yeah.
So you have a costly price tag as well.
Mm-hmm.
So when you know your worth,
yeah,
you hold your goods.
Yeah.
And you don't just give over to any, you know, vain conversation. You know what I mean?
Uh-huh.
Just hold on, because God, he's not taking it from you. He's holding it for you.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. So you said God, he's holding it for him. But what do you tell that one that is becoming so weary? And it seems as if they feel like half a man is better than no man.
Mm.
What do you tell them? Again, I understand the spiritual aspect of it. Be not weary, well doing. What do I do while I'm waiting? What do you tell them while they're waiting?
While you're waiting, you mm-hmm. be found busy doing the things of the Lord.
Okay.
Be found busy as you're waiting. You're serving
mm-hmm.
your local church. You're mm-hmm. serving.
Mm-hmm.
You know, find accountability partners.
Mm-hmm.
You know, keep yourself away from strange fire.
Wow. Keep your weight from what? I like that.
Strange fire.
I like that. Strange fire. Okay.
Because guess what? There's no good thing in our flesh.
Mm-hmm.
So we know that the flesh is weak.
Mm-hmm.
And you human. And guess what? God made us this way, women. He made us to desire companionship and love.
Mm-hmm.
And so a lot of times we want that more than we want to serve God.
Yeah.
But God is saying that we have to take back our authority.
Mm-hmm.
And our authority is in Him.
Yeah.
And in Him you find strength. In Him you find that confident, you know, that constant friend, mm-hmm. that covenant. You know what I mean? It's all in Him.
Yeah, it's in Him. So what you're saying is this. So it's safe to say that while you're waiting in Him, meaning that I like that. Hey, cousin, and while you're waiting in Him, I like the story of Ruth.
Mm-hmm.
Ruth was busy doing the things of God. You didn't find Ruth, even though she went through, husband passed away, things of that nature, but she found herself being accountable. Exactly. And I think that's where most of the single women get weary and well doing. They find themselves not being accountable. And when you're not accountable, then your flesh tends to get in the way.
Exactly.
And when your flesh gets in the way, then you find yourself making ill-advised decisions, and when you make ill-advised decisions, then you find yourself in situations that you know that if you were in your right mind,
exactly.
you wouldn't have made that decision. But because you allow your flesh
mm-hmm.
to get in the way, now that which you want God to bring you out of, now it's taking longer because you made that bed, as our grandma would say, you made that bed, so now you have to live in that bed.
That's true.
So while you're waiting, and so what you're saying, Pastor Brenda, so you're saying that while you're waiting, make sure that you're not waiting. There's not a weight of like an idle weight.
Exactly.
But it's a weight of, God, I'm going to give you glory.
And you don't wait begrudgingly.
Mm-hmm.
Don't wait in frustration.
Yeah.
You know, wait patiently.
Yeah.
And with good cheer.
Mm-hmm.
Because, you know, God said that He would not withhold any good thing from us.
Mm-hmm.
So He knows the desires of our hearts.
Mm-hmm.
And guess what? God don't even need our help.
That's good. That's good.
So we got to learn how to just stay busy
mm-hmm.
doing the things of God.
Yeah.
And I'm telling y'all what really works.
Yeah.
Had I listened, a lot of mistakes that I made,
mm-hmm.
I wouldn't have made them.
That's good, Pastor. One thing I love about our relationship, we are so candid. We're so transparent. I think sometimes people look at our situation, look at it, they say, oh, that doesn't make sense. But we knew that we were meant for each other.
Exactly.
We knew we were meant for each other, but
it was premature.
It was premature. It's so anything that is premature, like a baby. If you know anything about a baby that's premature, mm-hmm. the baby that's premature cannot get the nurturing of a fully 40-week-old baby.
Nice.
So it has to get
full-term.
A full-term baby. Thank right. you. So it has to go through extra care. It has to go through some extra things because it's not fully developed.
Right.
And I believe that's what happened with our relationship. Mm-hmm. When we lay eyes on each other, we knew that we were meant for each other.
Exactly.
But because we still had
to go before God.
We went before
and
God.
Guess what ended up happening?
Yeah.
We fail. And that was deja.
But
she was the best thing to happen to me, y'all.
Yes, she was. She was the best
because
thing.
Because she allowed me to grow up and mature. And I thank God for my baby. He chose me
mm-hmm.
to birth such a beautiful thing.
Yeah.
But had I waited on God,
yeah.
a lot of things that we went through together,
yeah.
we probably wouldn't have did it. It was our own disobedience.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So, and you know, sometimes it will bring shame on you
yeah.
when you fall into sin.
Yeah.
And He'll make you feel as though you're not worthy or, you know, you can't come back. But guess what? You can come back. And you
yes,
come back better than before.
Yeah. But you come back better than before. But this is the thing. I like what you said, that you have to first acknowledge the error of your ways. Because most of the time, many of us, we don't acknowledge
exactly.
our mistake.
Right.
And when you do not acknowledge your mistake, then what God wanted to do, God says, you have now tied my hand
exactly.
because now you're not acknowledging the error of your ways.
Right.
So, yes, when we lay eyes on each other, we knew that we were meant to be and mm-hmm. things of that nature. We knew that.
Mm-hmm.
But I was I was in a process myself.
Exactly.
I didn't deal with my rejection. Mm-hmm. I didn't deal with my lust. Mm-hmm. I didn't deal with a whole lot of things. And your side, you didn't deal with. Yeah, let's talk about your side. Glory to God, because you weren't perfect. Glory
no,
to God.
No, I wasn't.
Yeah, well, and
I had daddy issues. Yes, I was a daddy's girl.
Yes, she was a daddy's
and
girl.
And I compared my husband to my father, mm-hmm. and I wanted him to be my father. Crazy, right?
Yeah, very crazy.
But it was a lot of things that I needed to grow up.
Uh huh.
And I wasn't prepared.
Yeah.
To be a wife.
Yeah.
But guess what? They say marriage does what?
Marriage. Love is blind.
And that's what it says.
This is what they say. Love is blind, but marriage will open up both of your eyes.
I'm talking about wide like this.
Wide. Glory to God. I'm talking like Bobby Porter's wide. So even though we knew where we were meant
to
be.
What's going on, Tamika?
Even though we knew we were meant to be together, but because we didn't go through deliverance. And see, as I talked about earlier.
And even inner healing.
Yeah, that's what I talked about earlier. I talked about there is another step of deliverance. See, many of us, we go through deliverance, but we don't go through the next step. The next step is inner healing.
Exactly.
Y'all do me a huge favor. We got about 5 more minutes. Do me a huge favor.
Just five more minutes. I have a prison ministry.
Yeah, she's in and out. Do me a favor.
If you blink, you're going to miss it.
Yeah, do me a favor. Hold on, baby, now that you're here. Do me a favor. I need every one of you all to share this right now. Share this right now because we got some more nuggets that we want to give out to you all. We're going to be doing this a little bit more often.
Okay.
We're going to be doing this a little bit more often. Glory to God. Do me a favor. Share this right now. We're going to give you about 13 seconds to share this again, and we're just going to talk about a few more things. Amen.
Baby, you're not going to do this.
Yeah. Come on. We're going to talk.
Okay, y'all.
Share this right now. Come on, share this, y'all. We need y'all to share this. Where you going, Pastor Ray? Huh? Come on, share this. She's coming right back. Share this, y'all. Okay, come on back, Pastor Sabrina.
Cried out to Jesus, a little girl is dying in a day. But by the time the last...
Come on, y'all, share this right now. Here she's come. She's coming right back.
The girl had grown cold and succumbed to her fate. Now the family was wailing and the situation looked so grim. When he walked in her room and he
come on, y'all, share this.
Himself in.
Y'all know when I get up, I got to make sure I take full advantage of this. Glory to God. Because she doesn't like laughs. She doesn't like all of that. But so what we were talking about waiting on God. And I really feel compelled to say this because we have so, I believe that the body of Christ, emotionally, we're jacked up. And whenever you are operating in your emotions, you tend to make bad decisions. And so, what are some of the things that you would say? Give the singles women some advice. We understand the waiting part, but give them some advice. I need you to minister to these ladies right now. I want to put the camera
on.
Okay,
when you say advice, exactly what you mean? Like advice is... Far as
spirituality and in terms of what to look for in a mate, and what are some of the red flags you look for, and then what are some of the things that you look for in a mate? What are some of the things that you say that's a red flag? Stay away from that red flag.
Okay, so what I think honestly, I think first we have to work on yourself.
Yeah.
You got to make sure you're ready. You can't expect to have a millionaire and a man that got all these different things, but you don't have anything. Mm-hmm. So you want to bring something to the table.
Yeah.
As well as having all these high expectations on what you want a man to have.
Mm-hmm.
So that's number one. You got to work on you.
Yeah.
You have to have a banking account. You have to know how to take care of yourself. You know, you don't beautify yourself when you get a man. You got to present yourself. You got to prepare yourself.
Almost like the Esther treatment.
Exactly.
Because when Esther, the Bible speaks about Esther, the Bible says that Esther, she prepared herself. She didn't just come she didn't come to the king looking any kind of
exactly.
way. She had what we call an Esther treatment. She made sure that she adorned herself with beauty. She made sure that she
got to invest in yourself.
Yeah.
Don't expect a man to do what you're not even doing.
Mm.
So you got to take care. You got to love yourself.
That's
and guess
good.
What? someone will know when you love you mm-hmm. because there's a scent, a certain aroma that you have.
Yeah.
See, men can smell different scents on you. Mm-hmm. So if you have vulnerability on you, they can smell
they
it.
They can smell it.
If you have easy on you, mm-hmm. they can smell it. Mm-hmm. Whatever you got on you, you want to make sure that scent is a fresh scent.
Yeah.
So you got to ask God to clean you up.
Mm-hmm.
Because you don't want to go to a man. That's the problem we had. Mm-hmm. We both had issues.
Yes, we did.
So we came together foul. Mm-hmm. You know, but God, you know, put his hand on it eventually. Mm-hmm. When we and another thing you got to do, you got to die.
Yeah.
You can't be selfish and say, I do. Yep. It's no longer his stuff, my stuff, mm-hmm. his money, my money. It says the two became one.
Yeah.
So if you're not ready to become one, meaning you have to die. And the first thing you have to die to is self.
Yeah.
So that was my issue. Yeah. I wasn't ready to change my name.
Yeah.
I want to hyphenate my name. I'm like, why am I giving this man my name?
Come on, let's talk about that hyphenated name.
And at the end of the day, it was because I was still holding on to my father. I didn't want to let go because maybe there were some things or some areas in his life, my husband, that I didn't see that he was up to par. He was holding that standard that I had saw my father hold up in our household. So those things are things that you have to work out in the beginning.
Mm-hmm.
See, the thing is, a lot of marriages, they don't go wrong. They start wrong.
Mm-hmm.
So you have to allow people to come in and help you, to stand alongside of you. You know what I mean? We can't think we're a one-hit wonder where you can do everything by yourself. You need accountability.
Yeah.
Again, you need accountability.
Yeah.
If I had had accountability, a lot of things I did, I wouldn't have done them.
Yeah.
So I didn't see that. I saw my mom and dad, we've been married forever, but I didn't see that spiritual part.
Yeah.
So again, you got to have somebody that's not only natural, but can give you that spiritual advice.
Yeah.
Because if you're getting advice from somebody carnal, the first thing they're going to tell you is, girl, leave.
Mm-hmm.
That's carnal advice.
Yeah.
Why would you tell me to leave my husband when we have our first argument?
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, it's a lot.
Yeah.
But I'm telling you, when you wait on God.
Yeah.
When you wait on God.
Wait on God. Yeah.
You will make your way so much easier.
So much easier.
So don't go before God.
Yeah.
And while you're waiting, women.
Talk about that while you're waiting. I think that is so
key. Prepare yourself, baby.
Mm-hmm.
Because I'm going to tell you something. I know we think we're getting married because we want to get it in and do the, you know.
Mm-hmm.
But it's more to a marriage than that. Because a whole lot of nights, you're not going to want that joker to touch you, okay?
Mm-hmm.
So it's something about when you're single
mm-hmm.
and you having sex
mm-hmm.
versus when you get married. It's just something different. And maybe it's just me. Can I hear from the married women?
Oh, my God.
It's something about that sneaky sex that's just real, real good, y'all. So when you say I do, it's yeah. something different.
Yeah.
Because you feel like you can withhold it now.
Mm-hmm.
So I'm saying to you guys, be prepared.
Mm-hmm.
Don't rush it.
Yeah.
Let God prepare you
yeah.
as he's preparing your spouse.
Yes.
He already knows
mm-hmm.
your hearts. He knows our heart's desires.
Mm-hmm.
We don't have to keep reminding him.
Yeah.
You yeah. know, that gets on God's nerve. We keep telling him the same thing. He heard you the first time.
The first time.
So now what you need to do is go visit your mirror
mm.
and begin to ask God to take the ugly out of me.
That's good.
So that I can be ready for that man when you send him to me.
Mm-hmm.
I don't want to come halfway. I don't want a half-done cake.
Yeah.
My pastor used to preach about a half-baked cake.
A half-baked cake.
Ain't nothing worse than a half-baked cake.
Man.
And I'm going to be honest, a lot of us, we think we're ready,
mm-hmm.
but we're really not ready.
We're not ready. Talk that half-baked cake.
This your last point, Pastor
C. I got
you. Y'all know he can do this all night. Send up the hot.
Yeah, this is. That half-baked cake. Let's talk about the half-baked cake for a moment. This is what a half-baked cake is. After you did the ciphering, after you molded the cake,
yeah.
now the cake is in the oven, and because you are thirsty
yeah.
for this cake.
And you try to make the cake be done because you can't wait to taste the cake.
You can't wait to taste the cake because you done went through all of the preliminaries. You done did all of the stirring of the, you did all the mixture. And now every 5 minutes you're going to check the oven to see if it's ready.
Instead of just waiting and letting the time tell you
mm-hmm.
when the cake is ready.
Yeah, yeah,
you want to rush the process.
Rush the process.
And when we rush the process,
mm-hmm.
we make a mess up.
We make a mess. And there's nothing when you eat a half-baked cake.
Oh, God, it's the worst.
You taste a half-baked cake. You take the flour, you taste the flour,
gooey,
you taste all of that. And that's just like some of us mm-hmm. right now in relationships. Many of us, we are dealing with half-baked issues. And half of the half-baked issues are presented from us.
Yeah.
Many of us, we are half-baked. Many of us, we don't have a prayer life. Many of us, we don't have a study time
then
with God.
Then we stingy with yourself. A lot of us aren't even adoring ourselves. We won't even get our hair done.
Mm-hmm.
You won't go buy you an outfit.
Mm-hmm.
You're selfish.
Selfish.
So how are you going to be stingy with yourself and think you God going to bless you with this mighty man who got all this good stuff?
Yeah.
Really?
Yeah. And see, this is the thing, and I want to make sure that we talk about this. The thing about it is about what Pastor Sabrina and I, we were marriage pastors for 5 years. And I know some people may feel like, you know, now they are jumping on board and because everybody else is doing somewhat marriage talk. Boo, let me tell you something. We've been together 22 years. We've been married. Is it 19?
And let me ask y'all know something.
Mm-hmm.
The 22 years ain't always been good.
No.
Let me help you out. It's been times, and not that long ago, that me and my husband, I had made a decision. I was done with this.
Yeah.
Because it was too much.
Yeah.
But guess what?
Mm-hmm.
God gives us another chance, so why can't we give each other another chance?
Yeah. And so we've been together for 22 years. We've been married for 18 years. So we're not novice to this thing. Again, our first ministry, after God spoke to us and he told us that our mess was going to become our message.
Mm-hmm.
So which means that the very thing that we went through, God had allowed us to bring others out of what we've gone through because of what we went through.
Mm-hmm.
So we're not just jumping on board because we see a whole lot of people doing marriage seminars and all that kind of stuff, man. We didn't have marriage conferences.
Yeah.
I'm talking about every year my wife and I, we did marriage conferences. We did all of those things.
And we even had events at our home.
We had events at our home for married couples. So we've been doing.
And we didn't do, and I know I don't do, me and my husband, I don't do things for the spotlight. Because y'all mm-hmm. know I don't even like this. This is way out of my realm tonight.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know what's going on with me.
Yeah. That's God. Yeah, we're going to keep it right there. Because the real reason why, Pastor Britt, I think the reason why I want to say the reason why you're doing it tonight is because I believe that you're relatable.
Mm-hmm.
Not only are you relatable, but you are so candid. You're so transparent. You're so translucent. And so a lot of what we see in counseling, it's a lot of fluff.
Yeah, I can't get you out of fluff.
It's a lot of fluff that's going on. I mean, some people are not real. They're giving you what it is. What you see in Pastor Terrence and Pastor Brenna is what you're going
to
get.
I can't be. Someone came up to me the other day at church,
mm-hmm.
and she said, I love you so much because you're so real.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, it takes too much to be somebody else.
Too much.
And I don't even want to be around people that's not real.
Right.
I'm being honest. If I got to look behind my back and see if you're talking about me when I walk away, or I got to be careful what I say because you're going to judge what I'm saying, I'm not perfect.
Yeah, right.
Okay, I'm not. I'm sorry. I'm not.
Yeah.
So I just choose to stay away from those people. And guess what? A lot of times I'm with my family
mm-hmm.
because I could be me.
Yeah.
My family, they love me, whether my hair is done or whether my breath is stinky.
My God.
They love me with an unconditional love.
Yeah.
So guess what? I spend a lot of time here because I'm safe. This is my safe place.
Mm-hmm.
So again, I can't be nobody other than me.
Yeah.
And if you want me to be somebody, I had somebody tell me you got to fake it till you make it. I don't believe in that.
No.
Because if I got to be fake, then I'm not being real.
Right.
So that's another thing, women. We got to just be who we are.
Mm-hmm.
You got to be okay with who you are.
Yes.
It's okay to make changes.
Mm-hmm.
But love you.
Right.
Love everything about you.
Right.
Everybody ain't going to be, as much as I want to go back to my good size and my good shape.
My God.
My husband loved me just the way I am.
Just the way you are.
And guess what? I love all of him too.
Come on. You ain't got to do all that. You got to point all that out. You got to point all that out. Just stay focused. Just stay focused.
You got to point all this out. Once you love yourself.
Yeah.
That's all I want to say.
Self-love.
Value yourself.
Mm-hmm.
And when you love yourself, you will not allow people to mishandle you.
Mm-hmm.
I want you to watch how I treat me.
Mm-hmm.
So if I don't treat myself bad, you think I'm going to let you treat me bad?
Yeah.
I'm sorry.
Yeah. Yeah.
Amen.
Because your brother said, yes, I do love my big sister.
I love you, baby brother. On my soul.
Yeah. And so in our conclusion, I believe that this is the start of something because I believe that it's time for the body of Christ. And I've been talking about all this week about the anointing. And I've been talking about that in order for the church to get back to its place of authenticity, and in order for the church to get back to real power, I believe that it starts with the pastors. It starts with the priests. It starts with the Levites. Because how are we going to heal the people when we're jacked up? Mm-hmm. When we don't have a deliverance room. Exactly. When we don't go through inner healing. That's and when we don't go through inner healing, guess what? Man, the whole church is jacked up. And then we wonder, man, why we don't feel no power? One of the reasons why you don't feel power is because the priests, the pastors, the leaders.
It's like priests like people, right?
Priests like people. So we're out of order. Exactly. And so I believe by the Spirit of God that one of the things that God has, I believe tonight, because this is unscripted. We weren't even planning on doing this. Mm-hmm. I'm being honest with you.
I'm going to be honest with y'all. Yeah. Now, this is a real reason.
Yeah, yeah.
I came in my dining room. Uh-huh. And he got my whole dining room.
Yeah.
Like a studio.
Yeah, like a studio.
And low-key, I was just a little bit like, is this dude lost his man?
Yeah.
So then, yeah, that's how that happened.
Well, you know what the thing? I think this is actually preparation.
Yeah.
It was prophesied to us on four different occasions just this week alone that God is preparing us for a television show. It was prophesied that to us. And so I believe, again, I done brought me some new lights, you know, again, because I'm dark, y'all. I'm real dark. So I need everything to light me up, glory to God. I need to be lit up. And so I believe God is preparing us for something greater. And I believe that it's not only preparing us for something greater, that we can be relatable.
Exactly.
People are tired of the fluff that is going on in the church.
The part two, cousin, mm-hmm. We're going to have you and Minister Rick with us.
Yeah, we're going to do this. We're going to
tag team.
Yeah, we're going to do this thing. So in our conclusion, we want to just say this to those of you all that are, because I believe that we're going to go into depth. And one of the things that we always talk about in our marriage counseling, the first thing that we talk about is this. It's not lack of communication that destroys a marriage. It's not dishonesty of money that destroys a marriage. It's none of those things. Those are the branches or the byproduct of what has destroyed the marriage. Let me tell you what destroys marriages and what destroys relationships. I want to bless y'all with this. If y'all don't hear anything else I've said tonight, this is the main thing that destroys marriages and relationships. This one word, and that one word is dishonor.
That's right.
When you dishonor someone,
yes.
In essence, what you are saying,
yes.
I no longer value you. When you dishonor someone, in essence, what you are saying is not the lack of money that mm-hmm. destroys marriages.
Mm-hmm.
I'm going to go as far as to say, it's not even infidelity mm-hmm. that destroys marriage. Because mm-hmm. guess what? You can get healed. If there's been infidelity,
yeah.
you can get healed from that. But when you do not have honor,
yes.
for your mate,
that's right.
Because honor breeds love,
and it's a difference between honor and control.
Yes, yes.
Some
come
people
on.
Think my husband, oh, he controlled. No, he don't. He does not.
Are control. You speaking in general? Or you speaking about me?
No, I'm saying you don't. No, it's been said, you know,
what?
That my husband, he doesn't trust me. He don't control me. Y'all know the truth, right?
Right.
So I'm just saying, like, honor. It's a difference between honor and control.
Yeah. Yeah.
You know what I mean? And control is when you're just being dogmatic.
Yeah.
And honor is when you want to submit under. You yeah. know what I mean? You want to be submissive, you know?
Mm-hmm.
And guess what? We submit one to another.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I mean? I'm not a doormat.
Thank you, Pam. Pam said she never thought that. Thank you, Pam. But I ain't never heard that either. Glory to God.
No.
Because if you know my wife...
Yeah. I'm sorry.
Y'all pray for me, glory
I'm
to God.
I'm the oldest of two brothers, and I ran the house, y'all. So
yeah.
I know my place as a wife, though.
Right.
So I submit to my husband, and I follow him as he follows Christ.
Yeah.
We don't try to control or, be dogmatic toward each other.
Mm-hmm.
We try to watch the way we handle each other.
And you know, the one thing I really love about our relationship, Pastor Brina, is that there is really... no competition.
Oh, no.
I mean, we are each other's biggest fan.
Yeah.
Sometimes I push my wife more than she want to be pushed.
Yeah,
I'm her biggest
I'm good,
fan.
And I think I work well in the background.
No, but
I make things happen in the background. I don't have to always be in the light, and I don't have to have the mic and all that kind of stuff. I do well behind the scenes.
But that's good in being humble, Pastor Brent. I get that. But when is your season? When is your time? It's time for you to come forth. And I believe by the Spirit of God, one of the reasons why there's a spirit of frustration that has hit your life, and I'm going to prophesy to you, the reason why the spirit of frustration has hit your life, why things that you see that you can correct, one of the reasons why is because God is calling you to come forth. And because for whatever reason you don't want to come forth, God said it's not about your timing. It's about my timing. And I believe that it's the timing of God that people need to hear Sabrina Michelle Hazard right now.
Amen.
Yeah, they need to hear Sabrina Michelle right now. And so with that being said,
hey Audrey, I love you too.
And so what destroys a marriage is not the lack of money. Mm-mm. It's not infidelity. Mm-hmm. It's not the lack of communication. What destroys a relationship or even marriage is this one word, dishonor. It's dishonor.
And sometimes it's hard for us to honor when you haven't saw that.
That's good.
So if you grown up in a house where you didn't see your mom honoring a man, or you didn't see your dad honoring a woman, it could be hard for you. But at that point is when you go to prayer with that. Mm-hmm. And you ask God to help you. It says that if you lack anything, when you go to him, you ask him, he'll give it to you.
Mm-hmm.
So if that's an area where you need to be strengthened in, because it doesn't come easy for everybody to honor.
Yes, yes.
You know, because then you feel like you're losing your cool point, some men feel, you know. Mm-hmm. But it's not about that. It's about you have to die so that your relationship can live.
That's good.
Amen.
Say that one more time, Pastor Brina.
You have to die so that your relationship can live.
Yes.
So if you can't die, you might as well already do the benediction on that situation.
Yes. And so I say to you, we say to you, and that's this. I believe that God is calling for, as I've been talking about all this week, about the anointing. I believe that it's time that the church get back to a place of authenticity.
Mm.
We got a lot of gifted, we have a lot of talented people, but we don't have enough anointed people.
They're wild asses.
What are they, Pastor Brina?
Wild asses.
Did y'all hear what she just said? Mm. What are they, Pastor Brina?
They're wild asses.
The Bible called them wild asses. Mm-hmm. That means you uncontrolled, you out of control.
No commitment, no covenant, no loyalty. You're not loyal to a cheeseburger.
My God.
Don't even know how to be loyal.
Don't know how to be loyal.
And again, we have to teach this.
Mm-hmm.
I'm teaching my children even now about being loyal to each other.
Yeah.
Meaning that when you know a secret on your brother, you know something on your sister, it's not always for you to come rat them out to me.
Mm-hmm.
You guys work that out amongst yourselves, because mm-hmm. that's teaching them how to be loyal to each other. Now, if there's something that you know I need to know,
mm-hmm.
you need to share that.
Yeah.
But you have to train your children. It says train them up in the way that they should go.
Mm-hmm.
So if they don't see us being loyal,
mm-hmm.
how can we expect them being loyal?
That's good. That's good.
So it starts there. It starts in the home. And a lot of things that I'm learning through Pastor T is that a lot of adults are lacking attention. And they do anything for attention.
Yeah.
They kick, scream, pick me. You don't see me. Even if they have to create a lie. They want to do whatever they have to do to get some attention.
Mm-hmm.
So parents, we have to give our children attention.
Yeah.
This attention thing is severe. It's real.
Yeah, it's real.
So I try to love on my boys. I know they're getting big and they always say, Mom, you're doing too much. It don't matter. Mm-hmm. I'm going to love on them. I'm going to love on my, what do you call Deja? She's not an adult.
Yeah, she's an in-betweener. She's still my baby. I don't see her.
What do we call her? A young adult. She's a young adult. She's mm-hmm. maturing.
Mm-hmm.
So even her, I'm treating my baby. I'm teaching her how to, you know, I want to show her attention and love and hug her and kiss and tell her how special. Even my boys, because when they grow up and they didn't get that and they didn't see that,
mm-hmm.
it's a situation, y'all.
It's a situation. So with a lack of, so it's safe to say this, Pastor Brina, with a lack of validation
mm-hmm.
growing up as a child, so when you get older and because you didn't get validated or words of affirmation, so now you're seeking for attention that you didn't get as a child. And because you didn't get that attention when you were a child, now that which is now become as an adult, now you are a grown individual that's carrying out that you're carrying out. And now that you're carrying that thing out, so now you just all over the place.
Mm-hmm.
And when you all over the place, guess what? Then your rejection shows. When you all over the place, then your rebellion shows.
Yeah.
Then when you all over the place, then your stubbornness shows. So when all of that comes out, now we as spouses got to now heal that which should have been corrected when you were a child.
Yeah.
So I say to those of you all that are adults that are watching us right now,
mm-hmm.
that went through what we call the black sheep syndrome.
Exactly. You're not the black sheep. We have to call you the chosen
one. You're the chosen one. But those of you all that have gone through those type of things, what you should be saying is, God, before I say I do,
yeah.
I need for you to heal me in every area in which I've hurt.
That's right.
Let me say that again. Before you say I do, because you know, if nobody else knows you, you know you.
You know.
So what you should be saying is, God, heal me in every area in which I hurt.
That's right.
And when you ask God to heal you in every area in which you hurt, so when you present yourself to your spouse, or when your spouse see you, you don't look for them to make you complete.
Exactly.
No one can make you complete.
That's right.
Let me say it again. No one can make you complete. What they can do, they can enhance you, but they can't make you complete.
That's right. And the word of the Lord says that we are already complete in Christ.
We're already complete in Christ. That's right. And that's another reason why, they act, because they don't know who they are spiritually.
That's right.
And we don't know who you are spiritually. Now you're looking, you got what we call identity theft. You don't know who you are.
We don't know who you are.
And a byproduct of identity theft is a spirit called arrested development.
Yeah.
What is arrested development? You always starting and stopping. Yeah. You inconsistent. You got a varying spirit attached to you.
Mm-hmm.
So before you say I do, make sure that your past is not attached to you.
Exactly. And you got to have some staying power.
Yeah.
So you got to make sure that you got longevity.
Yeah, longevity.
You know, because nowadays we say, well, we get married, but hey, if it don't work, I'm going to get a divorce. That's the wrong idea.
Yeah. Yeah.
It should be to death do us part.
Mm-hmm.
Because what is marriage?
Marriage is
a lifetime sentence
without the possibility of parole.
That's right.
I need someone to write that right now. That's a t-shirt. Marriage is a lifetime sentence
yes.
without the possibility of parole. Let me say that again. I need someone to type that in. Get me that t-shirt. Marriage is a lifetime sentence without the possibility of parole.
That's right. So you can't go in and thinking, if it don't work, I'm going to get this thing 6 months, and if it don't work,
mm-hmm.
wrong idea, you're not ready.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
You're not ready. Get back in your closet.
Yeah.
Get back in your closet, sister. You're not there yet.
Yeah.
Yeah. Tell God to purge you.
Yeah, purge you.
Tell him to clean me.
Mm-hmm.
Tell him to fix me, make me better.
Yeah.
But you're not ready.
You're not ready.
It's an accident waiting to happen.
Accident waiting to happen. But you got, again, it starts with you.
It starts with you.
You can't put that onus or put that kind of pressure on your spouse.
Right.
You can't put that kind of pressure on your fiance. You got to go through personal deliverance
That's
yourself.
Right. That's right.
You do. You can't say, well, this is that when I get married, things will look better. Let me tell you something.
No, baby.
Man.
Ooh, girl, Ooh. Let me tell you.
Tell them, Pastor Brittle.
If you think that
marriage is going to fix your lust demon.
Run fast, baby.
Yeah. If you think
it's going to intensify.
It's going to intensify. Marriage does not solve your lust problem. It doesn't.
Mm-mm.
As a matter of fact, it enhances. How does it enhance it? Now you say to yourself, I got one person I got to sleep with for the rest of my life. Uh-uh. No, I'm going to go back out there and start doing what I used to do. I'm going to say that again.
And that's a good way for a joker to get killed, right?
Yeah.
Right.
Hey, boo, that's my baby right there. We just talked about you earlier, Daisy. You know we can't, Daisy, you know we can't really talk about, tell a story without including you in our story. Glory to God, because you're a part of our story.
That's right. She has literally grown up with us.
She has literally grown up with us.
Maybe too much. But
too much.
It just caused her to be wise.
But you know what? One thing, I like what you said about this. She may have saw too much. But I thank God that what she saw, it didn't damage her.
It didn't.
I'm going to say that again. What my baby saw didn't damage her. For the first 4.5 years of our marriage was total chaos.
Yes. I went home every weekend, y'all.
Let's talk about that real quick.
At least for the first couple. I mean, it had to be the first 2 years.
The first.
Every weekend.
Oh my God.
I went home. I had my dad come pick me up. I was like, I can't do this.
Yes.
I don't like him.
Yes.
And guess what my daddy did? He came. He came kicking, fussing, and screaming.
Well, Pastor Brittany,
but
he
came.
Hold on. You got to stay right there. Let's pause right there. You said something.
What I said?
Every weekend, she came home, y'all.
Every weekend.
I need y'all to hear this.
And
again.
Guess what? Me and my daughter, we even did. Y'all remember the movie Enough? Now we telling them too much.
We telling them too much in one session.
They're
gonna read the book. Cause guess what? We got so much more.
So
we working on our book, y'all.
And let me tell you something. The stuff in the book is real life. Like we've been through some stuff.
Yes, we have.
So me and my daughter. Now at this time, Deja had to be about what? She was young.
Yeah, Deja.
She was like maybe. We got married. She had been about 3, 4, but she always been advanced.
Mm-hmm.
So anyway, He made me mad. And again, I was a spoiled brat. I'm just going to tell the truth. I was rotten.
My God.
I was used to getting my way how I wanted it. Mm-hmm. He made me mad about something. Mm-hmm. I told Deja, and I should not have done this. Mm-hmm. I told her, we're going to run away in the middle of the night. I said, you know how we do this. Go get your stuff and put it by the door. Ooh. As soon as he falls asleep, we out of here.
Yes.
And she said, okay, mommy. She went and knew how to pack her little bag at four. Mm-hmm. I had my little stuff together. Mm-hmm. Got ready to go and run away, y'all. The car wasn't there. I forgot I had left my car at my mother's house. Mm-hmm. Guess what I did, y'all? I stole his car. Now, how I'm going to run away and take his car knowing he had to go to work? Immature. Mm-hmm. Wasn't ready for marriage.
Wasn't ready for marriage.
So me and my baby, we ran away. Mm-hmm. And we went to my mother's house. Now, my mother, God bless her heart, she's going to roll with me good, bad, or ugly. Mm-hmm. She's my ride or die. Mm-hmm. She let me hit the car in the garage. And I told her, if he come, don't let him in.
My God.
So this is the kind of nonsense. Now, why would I want to put my baby through this?
Yeah.
Immature, wasn't ready, hadn't died, selfish, spoiled, rotten brat. That's what I was.
Yes.
But what can you say about that, Pastor T?
I should have left that joker where she was. That's what I can say about that. Glory to God. I should have left her where she was. But again, we both came with issues. We both had issues, undealt with issues. Yeah. And when you come into a marriage with undealt with issues, then now you're creating chaotic situations.
Yes.
I mean, yeah, mine was, I had pride. I had a spirit of lust on me.
He was stingy.
I was stingy.
He would come to my parents' come on, house, y'all. Listen to this.
Why are you trying to make
now
me? Let's tell on you. Let's tell your cons. You want to talk about my cons, but let's tell your cons.
Let me tell this one last thing.
My God, you want to talk about my cons? Talk about yours.
My mother and father's house to visit me. We were dating at the time, right? Or were you married? We might have been married. I don't know.
I think
he would
dating.
Come there and he would have a 2-piece chicken dinner from, what do you call that place? Church's Chicken.
Uh-huh.
I said, Joker, how you going to come here and eat a 2-piece chicken dinner and there's 5 people in the house? You eat that outside. You don't bring it in here. That's selfish. Mm-hmm. So I had to show my husband because he wasn't used to that.
Right.
So I had to help him. But guess what? He helped me in some areas.
Yeah, a lot of them.
He gave me a lot of patience. You know? And we shouldn't pray for patience.
No, we shouldn't.
But you need grace.
You need the grace of God.
And especially when you're dealing with a special one, you need grace.
You dealing with
a different A different kind of grace, y'all.
No, you the FBI. Talking about dealing with it. No, you the FBI. Good Lord. Talking about dealing with a special. No, you the...
But yeah, y'all. So, I'm just saying, we had so many. It was just... But we learned and we grew together. Mm-hmm. And guess what? Even in our adult age, we made mistakes. Mm-hmm. And guess what? We learned from those mistakes. It don't mean I get mad now. Guess what? I'm like, Joker, I'm not leaving my house. Mm-hmm. So you're going to sleep in here or go in one of them other bedrooms. But guess what? This is my house.
Yeah.
So it's like you have to work through things.
Yeah.
And we learned now. We try not to go to bed mad at each other. Mm-hmm. You know, we try to, we have disagreements. We call it... heated fellowship. It's okay.
Heated fellowship. I
it
like
makes
that.
Your marriage stronger. Mm-hmm. You got a marriage that's perfect. I'm afraid of it.
So
I just tell you guys, I have enjoyed tonight.
Yeah.
Probably said a little more than I thought I would. But I just want you guys to stay on the wall.
Yeah.
Keep your face turned to Jesus.
Yeah.
Because he will never, never let you down.
Never.
He's been a constant friend for me. I'm telling you, when I think about all the things that he's done for me, all the growth that he's allowed me to even see in myself, I get excited.
Yeah.
We're not perfect,
yeah,
but we are perfected through Christ.
That's right.
And our main mission is just to see people not go through the things that we have went through.
Yeah.
If my story could help you, I'm willing to share it. Mm-hmm. But if you're going to judge my story,
yeah,
then I'm just not willing to share it.
Yeah.
Amen.
That's good. And with that being said, Pastor Breen, I believe that again, as we've been hearing prophetic words about television that's getting ready to come our way, and we've been hearing this over the years, but I believe that it's the Kairos moment right now. I believe this is the timing of God for it to take place because it's so much fake stuff that's in the world today. As number 45 called it, fake news. There's so much fake stuff going on in the world today. And because there's so much fake stuff going on in the world, we don't know what's real. many of us, we know how to fake it until we make it.
Sometimes they see our love because we just have fun together. Yeah. It's like my best friend. Mm-hmm. He get on my nerves.
Oh, my.
He push. He's my tormentor.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
But guess what? We enjoy each other.
Yeah. Yeah.
We love each other. For real, it's not fake. Mm-hmm. So we enjoy being together. We always together. You're not going to really see me without him and my children. Yeah. That's just how we roll.
Yeah.
And if my husband and my kids can't come, really, I don't want to come.
Yeah.
You know, I enjoy doing my things that I do with my ladies at the church. I love that. You know, he allows me the time to go away with the women and get refreshed and to download and hear from them. But it's nothing like that quality time that we get to spend together. So. Yeah. We just want to be as organic as we can be. We just want to be as authentic as we can be. And if we can help you in any way, that's our main motion. That's our main mission.
Yeah.
That's our main mission.
That's our main mission. And what we want to say to those of you all that are unmarried, because the Bible doesn't call you single. The Bible calls you unmarried. What we want to say to those of you all that are unmarried, find yourself in a place of falling in love with God.
That's right.
Find yourself in a place of saying to yourself, until my mate comes,
yes,
I'm going to do everything that I can to show God that I am trustworthy.
That's right. You want God to remove every foul fingerprint.
Yes. Remove the films. Yes.
Fingerprint that's on you.
Yeah.
For allowing people to touch you
mm-hmm.
that they shouldn't even had a conversation with you.
Yeah.
But because you were vulnerable and you made it get caught at the wrong moment, at the wrong time, and you found yourself doing the wrong things, those are the things that God wants to detox you of.
Yes. He wants to detox you of. And see, when you go into a marriage detoxed, when you go into a marriage with no residue of your past, I'm telling you all by the Spirit of God that you can have heaven down here on earth.
Yes.
Let me say that again. When your prayer is, God, cleanse me
yes.
of any film that looked like my past,
yes.
whether it be lust, whether it be perversion, whether it be rejection, whether it be stubbornness, whatever your issues are, your prayer should be, God, I want to, when I stand before holy matrimony, when I stand before a holy God, I want to present myself, not just saying that I haven't been touched sexually. I want to make sure that my past does not enter into my newness.
That's right.
Amen. This is Pastor T. It's Pastor Brina.
Along with Pastor Sabrina.
Yes, we absolutely love y'all. Again, and even those, let me just speak to, we want to say this to those of that went through a divorce.
Yeah.
I want to speak to that.
That's right. Because there is life after divorce.
There's life after divorce. Can I tell them my story, Pastor Brina?
Go ahead, tell it.
You want me to tell it?
Tell it.
Okay, let me come out this jacket.
No,
I won't be long. I'm just getting a little hot. You're breathing all on me. Glory to God. You see, Miss. Hey, boo.
Hey, Miss.
We want to talk a little bit about life after divorce. There is life after divorce. I was married prior to Pastor Brenham. I know some of y'all don't. Y'all like, wow, for real? Again, it's gonna all be in the book. We gonna do a tell all book. So you won't.
Can't nobody beat us telling our story.
Because I promise you, we're not gonna leave nothing out. We gonna tell it all: the good, the bad, and the ugly. I was married prior to me marrying her. I knew going into this marriage, my first marriage, that I was not going to stay married. But for whatever reason, I went into the marriage knowing that there was no connectivity. But I tried to make things work.
At the age.
No, I wasn't ready. I was 19 years of age. I had
Deja's age.
Yeah, I was Deja's age. I was my baby's age. I was 19 years of age. I had my son at the time, little Terrence. Mm-hmm. And so again, so I wanted to do the right thing because I grew up with my father. So I didn't want my son to go grow up without his dad in the home. So I my motives were right.
Yeah.
My motives were right, but it wasn't the timing.
That's right.
I wasn't mature enough. You know, to have a child. So, I mean, to be in a marriage. So, I went through that. God brought me out of it. I met my wife. And we met in 1997. I'll never forget that. In 1997.
And I'll tell y'all something.
Mm-hmm.
He met me But I was where I shouldn't have been. Mm. So again, he was my husband. But had I been on my post, mm-hmm. I had played hooky from the choir that night.
Right.
And I ended up sitting next to this joker.
My God.
He was full of lust. Because all he was doing is looking at my legs, trying to size me up.
Yes, I was.
And guess what? Mm-hmm. I didn't fall for it right away.
Yeah.
But eventually.
Yeah.
He kept playing with me,
mm-hmm.
and he stuffed my heart up.
No, I did.
But had I been where I should have been,
mm-hmm.
which was up there singing
mm-hmm.
in the choir stand
yeah.
on my assignment,
yeah.
guess what?
Yeah.
I wouldn't have been like, wasn't that Bathsheba who was on the rooftop taking a bath?
Yeah, it was Bathsheba. Yeah.
She was on the rooftop taking a bath.
Yeah.
She know she was seducing that man. She was in the wrong place. Both of them shouldn't have been doing it.
Mm-hmm.
We like to always talk about Bathsheba, but guess what? He wasn't in the right place.
Uh-huh.
And she knew he was watching.
Yeah.
That's mm-hmm. what I think. That's my version.
Yeah, that's your version.
I knew he was watching.
Mm-hmm.
So I wanted to let him see what happened.
Glory to God.
But anyway, yeah. that's what the next time.
Yeah. We got so much. I'm telling you, my wife and I, we're writing a book for real. We're writing a tell-all book. We won't have ghostwriters. It's gonna be us. Us writing the book. And so, again, so life after divorce. So I went through divorce, and when I came out of my divorce, when I laid eyes on her, I knew she was my wife, but I still wasn't cleansed.
He was dirty. Y'all.
I was filthy. I was a whore.
Ooh.
Yes, I was a whore.
Ooh.
Yeah. Again,
he was a street man in a church.
I was
the Bible.
I was known as a Pentecostal pimp.
My God, no, an apostolic pimp.
No,
that's horrible, y'all.
A baptized in Jesus' name.
How did God let that happen? Huh?
Okay, Pastor Brandon, come on.
He was a... Oh, my God.
Yeah. Pastor Brandon, come on. Don't act like you... my sin may not was your sin.
No, I was saved, sanctified, and filled with the Holy Ghost. Precious gift of the Holy Ghost.
No, you wouldn't. Get that religious spirit up out of here. I bind and rebuke that religious demon now. But I say that to say that... Even though we got married prematurely, God.
Pam says she don't want it all. We got to get a cleanse, cause
yeah. Even though I knew she was my wife,
yeah.
God allowed again premature. We talked about that premature baby.
Yeah.
And for four years, our marriage went through total hell.
Yes, it did.
We went through some major situations, all because we didn't get cleansed.
Yeah.
He had to have it, y'all. He had to have me. No, Pastor Brittany, again, you're not telling the truth, Pastor Brittany. There's a lying spirit on you.
Glory.
Yeah, I want God to hear you from
that. We had to have each other. We just couldn't get enough.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And it was prophesied to me that you spending too much time with him one-on-one.
Yeah.
And I said, the devil is a lie.
Mm-hmm.
I got this thing.
Yeah.
Probably that night I fell.
Yeah. I saw her. I'll never forget at St. James Church of God in Christ. She was in the choir. She was on fire. And this one particular, I was so fixed on her. I was so fixed on her. And I just knew every time I would try to make eye contact with her and say, you know, hey, can we get together? She was in the choir. If you confess the Lord, call him up. And this one time.
Yeah. Was at the wrong place.
That one time that she did not sing in the choir.
Yeah, that one night.
And it was, the church was, if you know 10920 South Princeton at St. James, if you know anything about that their 8 o'clock service, you cannot get a seat. You cannot get a seat. But God orchestrated once.
I don't know if that was God.
It was God.
That was not God.
It was God.
The devil had his hands all on that
one. Okay. That's your story. You stick to it. It was one seat in the entire building. It was next to me. She sat next to me. And you know anything about St. James, Pastor Cameron gonna make you hug about 50 times in one service. And we hugged about 50 times in that one service.
And then every time we moved, I felt like this joker was getting close to me.
Ooh, when we were in a service, we would hug each other. As we were hugging each other, I wouldn't let her go. And my God, I know Pastor Campbell probably at the time, you know, he probably like, there's a demonic spirit over there. I wouldn't let her go because I was saying, I want her.
But see, I had been, like I told y'all, I was Bathsheba that night. So I was watching him too. I was like,
Yeah.
I always watched the man's shoes.
Yeah, what I had so on some gators
shoes,
that night.
If your shoes weren't right, then I wasn't even going to talk to you.
Yeah.
I worked my way up.
Mm-hmm.
I said, okay, he kind of put together.
Mm-hmm.
But so I lost focus.
Yeah, she lost focus. She couldn't take her eyes off me, y'all.
No, that's
too far. No. We're going to tell the truth. If you're going to be saved, be
that
saved.
That was too far.
No. You just got through saying you was watching. You watched me from the...
But then I got back in the spirit. No, I knew how to be...
You couldn't have got back in the spirit because guess what?
What?
You gave me your number. Did you give me your number?
No, I did not.
Oh, you didn't give me your number?
You gave me your number.
Okay. But she hit that. I had to have it. Glory to God.
I'm going to let him just tell that part.
Okay. All right. Facebook.
But anyway, he kept coming close to me. We're going to close on this for real.
Mm-hmm. Hold on. Do that. I'm going to get my shirt.
He kept coming. He just kept coming. Every time we say, touch your neighbor, I'm like, and so I said, wait now. I said, are you getting closer to me? Yeah, oh, no, lying. Oh, no. I said, okay, well, then scoot over a little bit. Now I have to get aggressive with that demon because I saw it. But then I'm thinking, like, this dude trying to do too much. But had I been at the right place at the right time, y'all, that wouldn't have, none of that would happen. He would have found me busy working, doing the things that God had called me to do. So I don't know what he wanted to do, y'all, but I have enjoyed myself.
Yes.
And I can't say when, but I will be back.
Yes, she'll be back. We're going to do this on a regular basis,
okay,
y'all.
Okay, now you're going too far.
No, I'm not. I believe God is really dealing
okay,
with
baby,
you.
Okay, baby, come on, ready
okay.
to stop
now. No, you ain't ready to stop. Listen, be, look, I got
y'all know I get in and out. This okay. is too much.
Okay, listen. In my conclusion, my wife and I, we've launched our T-shirt business. We've launched it.
I want to get my T-shirt.
Okay, she want to get her T-shirt. We've launched our T-shirt. This is one of my T-shirts. It's called the Blessing Connector. I did a series on.
Don't give them the story on it. It's too much.
Don't give them the story.
No, just show them
okay.
the T-shirt.
This is one of my. It said the Blessing Connector. Then my wife has her shirt, and it's talking about the Proverbs 31 woman. This shirt won't come out until. A couple of weeks.
Yeah, we're working on.
We're working on a few things, but we just want to just give you a briefing of her shirt. Look at this. It talks about being that Proverbs 31 woman. The Proverbs 31 woman is she's a
woman of noble character.
Uh huh.
She's a good wife.
Mm-hmm.
Say it again. A good wife.
A good wife.
She's honorable.
Uh huh.
That means she's loyal.
Mm-hmm.
She is a provider.
Mm-hmm.
She's strong.
Mm-hmm.
She's wise. Mm-hmm. And guess what? She's you and she's me.
Mm-hmm.
And on the back. Y'all know I love cheetah, everything.
Mm-hmm.
So it's the 31, and it's got leopard print,
mm-hmm.
or you can get it without the leopard print.
Yeah.
So this is my shirt.
Yeah, Proverbs 31, that's her line, amen, but it all be under the umbrella TDH, Glory to God Collections. So again, this is the Blessed Connector, the one that's really selling. I thought I had one of them out here, but you all done saw me wear it.
Yeah, that's my baby.
Yeah, you all done saw me wear it. It's called, If You Give the Devil an Inch, He Becomes the Ruler.
Yeah.
I'm asking all of you all, if we've been a blessing to you all in any shape, form, or fashion, if we prophesied to you, if the lives have blessed you, who Pam, driving over to get my peaceful price. You ain't got nothing but money, Pam, cut it.
Right.
So we're asking you all to be a blessing to us. If we've been a blessing to you all, we're asking you all to please.
Is that Danielle?
That's Danielle. That's your sister. That's Tanya.
Hey, Tanya.
Yeah.
Come on, sister.
Yeah, so we're asking you all to be a blessing to us. If we've been a blessing to you all down through the years, be a blessing to us. Now it's time to sow back. Amen?
Amen.
Y'all know Pastor T love to leave out with a song. I'm going to leave out with this song. We want to leave out with this song. Come on, send up the thumbs, send up the hearts.
Y'all know what he do.
Y'all send up the thumbs, send up the hearts. We're done. This is our song for the night.
I love you guys. And you guys be encouraged.
Yeah. In our conclusion, we said be encouraged. Pastor Brenda, give them the last words.
Baby, I'm all talked out.
You ain't all talked out. I need you to operate in a place
all
called.
All I can say is that I love you guys. I want y'all to be encouraged. I want you to stay on your post. And wives, they say that a man would rather be on a rooftop than in a house with a cantankerous woman. Mm-hmm. So if you know that's you tonight in your prayer time, in your long time, I want you to steal away and ask God to help you. To help you not be that cantankerous woman. Mm-hmm. To not be that woman that's always nagging, fussing, and complaining. Mm-hmm. But begin to honor your husband. Because guess what? If you don't honor them, and if you don't show them that affection, or you don't give them those compliments, as soon as they go out in the street, guess who's going to do it? Mm-hmm. Shenanigans. Mm-hmm. So guess what? You can't let no street woman beat you honoring the door and your man. Mm-hmm. Okay? Yeah. So that's my advice to you. Love on your husband. Mm-hmm.
Now, what do you say to the singles? Because we got a lot singles, of
singles, I say, go back to what I said before. Love yourself. Mm-hmm. Begin to pamper yourself. Adore yourself. Spend time alone. It's okay. It's okay to take walks alone. It's okay to even go on dates by yourself. Mm-hmm. It's okay. Yeah. Let God see that you're working on you.
Yeah.
Show him. Give him something to work with.
I preached a message. I want to be in a position where I make God bless
That's
me.
That's right.
Make God send you a husband.
You don't want to be thirsty.
Yeah.
Don't be desperate.
Yeah.
The first man that say you cute, that's not your husband, boo. Mm-hmm. That man was just giving you a compliment. Mm-hmm. The first man that say you look nice don't mean they want to be with you. Mm-hmm. So learn how to take a compliment.
Yeah.
Amen.
Amen. We love y'all. We love y'all. I need
Remember,
someone.
Remember, you top shelf.
You're top shelf.
So make that joker reach up top to get you.
Right.
Not down low. Mm-hmm. You top shelf.
Top shelf. Meet us this coming Sunday, 411 East 43rd Street. 411. I need someone to please be my personal moderator and type in 411 East 43rd Street. This coming Sunday. As of late, we've been experiencing God on a whole nother stratosphere.
That's right. Wait, my cousin said something real good. Mm-hmm. And just because you married, you still need to keep yourself together.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
If you know your man been going all day to work, when he come in, he don't want to see you in that dirty duster.
Like, yeah.
And your hair all over your head. Go beautify yourself.
Yeah.
Get yourself ready. Because mm-hmm. he been out there in the street and he saw all kind of stuff.
Mm-hmm.
All kind of hot thoughts.
Yeah. Mm.
And they ready to drop it like it's hot. Let me tell you.
Mm-hmm.
They willing to do it.
Mm-hmm.
But as long as you doing what you supposed to do, can't no other woman touch you. Mm-hmm. And if they do, it ain't because you didn't do what you was supposed to do.
That's good, Pastor. Amen. That's good. Meet us this coming Sunday. I saw my sister-in-law, Tanya. She just typed in the address. So what that means that she's going to be there Sunday.
I sure want to see my sister-in-law.
Tanya Simmons just typed the address. That means that she's going to be there. I want to challenge all of y'all that are watching us right now. I want you all to meet us this coming Sunday. We're about to experience God on a whole nother. Literally, not over-exaggerating, not hyperboling, not overstating it. We've been literally experiencing the weight of God's glory. Sunday and yesterday, God took our breath away. Mm-hmm. We experienced God on a whole nother stratosphere.
And that's because we've been fasting.
Yeah.
And
yeah.
We've been seeing miracles, signs, and wonders. And I want to say we're on like day 10 of our fast today. Mm-hmm. And God has really been blowing my mind. He's been showing me some things in me. And he's been bringing up some things that I thought I was delivered from. Some things that I thought I had let go. Mm-hmm. And he would begin to show me those things. So then those are the things that I would take to him in prayer. So I challenge you guys. Meet us Sunday.
Yeah.
Get there.
Yeah.
And I promise you, we're going to be out by 4:30.
Going to be out by
4:30. I promise you.
Yeah.
We're going to be out by 4:30.
Yeah. Our daughter, Lady Lunchabelle, just say, hey, my parents. Lady Lunchabelle, I want you to tell Lady Lunchabelle to get
Lady
to church.
Lunchable.
I need you to talk. Tell Lady Lunchabelle.
Girl, I need to see you.
Yeah.
I need to see you Sunday.
Yeah.
Be my guest.
Yeah. What's the fast? Again, we've been fasting from 6 a.m. Anybody know me know that I am not a person that loves to fast. I just don't do fast well. Doesn't mean that I'm not saved. Doesn't mean that I don't hear from God. But I just don't do well with fast. King's stomach has a way of taking over. Mm-hmm. I'm just going to be candid. But my wife called this fast.
After much prayer.
At first, I wanted to fight her on it. How are you going to call the fast? Blah, 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 blah. But literally, we've been seeing miracles take
even
place.
Even up until today, someone has been believing God for a kidney.
Mm-hmm.
And his daughter, she went on a fast with us. She didn't start with us, but she ended up catching on.
Mm-hmm.
And today, we got the notification that her mom had received her kidney. Mm-hmm. She had went through surgery and everything was done.
Yeah.
Another daughter had been believing God for a job.
Yeah.
She'd been all over trying to find a job. I told her, commit to this fast. I challenge you to kill this flesh with me. Mm-hmm. Let's seek the face of God. Let's go a little deeper. Mm-hmm. And she received a job on yesterday.
On yesterday.
So we've been seeing God opening doors for us. We've been seeing him making ways through this fast. So I challenge those of you that are our cyber family, come on and join us.
Yeah.
We're praying every day from at 6 a.m. and then we pray at 6 p.m. and we're doing 6 to 6. And this week we did the Daniel fast.
Mm-hmm.
So we're really just being led of the Lord on what God would have us to do. And from each week, we have a different prayer directive that we will go before God on.
Mm-hmm.
So it's been awesome. It's been amazing. Mm-hmm. And I feel refreshed.
Yeah.
And I feel renewed.
Yes.
Amen.
I'm telling you all, God is going to unlock some things before the end of this month.
Yes.
And we got 3 days left in this month. I'm telling you, I feel prophetic right now. I believe that God is about to unlock some things within the next couple of days on your behalf.
Yes.
God says, because you've been faithful, because you've been diligent, and because you've been consistent, God says, I'm about to unlock that which has been held up, all because you have gotten to the trenches.
Yes.
Meet us this coming Sunday.
Meet me, LaShawn Taylor.
Yeah. I'm going to go as far as to say this, Pastor Brenda, that if they don't experience God on Sunday, we'll replenish their gas.
Yeah.
Did y'all hear what I just said? If you don't experience God this coming Sunday in our services, see me at the service, and I'll make sure that the gas that you wasted getting to our church, we'll give it back to you.
But you got to come with an open heart.
You got to come with an open heart.
And an open spirit.
And an open spirit, ready to receive. The doors will open up at 1 o'clock. The doors will open up at 1 o'clock. We're going in at 1:49. God's going to blow your mind, Lady Lunchbell. Get there. Tell Lady Lunchbell.
Get there, Lady Lunchbell.
We want no excuse.
No excuses. I want to see you. Mm-hmm. I want to see LaShawn Taylor, too.
Uh-huh. And then you say you want to see Tanya?
Tanya Simmons.
Mm-hmm.
I want to see you.
And we want to see Pamela Claiborne.
Oh, God, that would bless my heart.
Yeah.
If I saw her and Minister Rick walk through that door, I think I'd take a lap.
Glory to God. Pam just logged back on. Pam, I don't know if you just hurt your cousin. She said if you walk through those doors Sunday, she's going to take a lap around the church building and LaShawn. Amen.
Them a lot of laps. We're going to lose them pounds for Jesus on Sunday.
Them LBs coming off of you, baby.
Hey.
They coming off of you, baby. No excuses.
No excuses.
Amen.
Well, I love you all.
We love y'all. You be blessed.
Have a great night.
Have a great night. This is the Hazards. We are the Hazards. What we've been through, we're about to tell you how not to go down that path. We're going to save your life with our testimony. Amen.
And our mess
and
has
I'm,
definitely become yeah, our ministry.
Our mess has definitely become our ministry.
Yes.
This is the Hazard, and we're out of here.
Bye-bye.
Be blessed.